Lynn Snodgrass, the CEO of the Best Darn Chamber in Oregon, soon to be the Best Darn Chamber in the Pacific Northwest. I love my job. That's my stump speech, and I'm very, very grateful for it. All right, I want to thank specifically some important members that we have here today. Our presenting sponsors are Portland General Electric. We thank them so much. And Riverview Community Bank. Larry, where are you today? Larry, thank you very much for your sponsorship, as well as Portland General Electric. We want to thank our education sponsor, Gresham Barlow School District. I didn't see anyone from the school district here today besides the chair of the board, which you're going to hear from later. But thank you very much. You can pass that on. And we also want to thank our media sponsor, MetroEast Community Media. Keith does an amazing job with all of the telecasts. And there's flyers listing the replay times of this luncheon. They're available on the registration table, as well as the replay times of our economic summit. I'll bring that up in just a minute. We would like to recognize any elected officials that are here today. Some are going to make presentations to you, but I'd like all of our elected officials to stand up right now so that we can honor all of you at the same time. So if you're elected to anything, please thank you so much. Could we applaud them? Their public service. Thank you so much. And I would be foolish if I didn't recognize my boss today, the chamber board members that are present with us today, the president of the chamber, Warner Allen of Warren Allen LLP. Thank you very much. And you know what I really like about what you do for us, Warner, is you bring Bonnie. So thank you so much. I also want to introduce from Resolution, Sue Hughes is a board member. Sue, where are you? Thank you so much. Well, we've had some incredible high points in the last 30 days at the chamber, and I'm going to mention just a few because I don't get a chance to brag very often to so many people all at once. We had our very first Gresham Area Leadership Academy start in the last 30 days, and it went off with a huge success. It is going to change the leadership role of Gresham. So I'm so grateful for that opportunity. It's an organization, it's a class that's put on by the Gresham Chamber. We had a sold out economic summit called Millennials, Management, and Me, featuring a national speaker. It was engaging, entertaining, and informative. Going back to the entertaining part again. There were flyers on the registration table so that you could watch the replay of that event. If you didn't have a chance to see it, or even if you did, there was so much humor that morning and so much information. Be sure and grab a flyer and watch the replay. Thanks again to MetroEast. Measure 97 is in full swing. Our strong opposition as a chamber to that measure is making a difference in our community, and we want to keep that going. So there's signs and literature out in the foyer there. It's available for you to take and to share that information. Take a visible stand, a no on 97. And last Friday, the chamber had the joyful pleasure of putting on the celebration for our two Olympic champions. Two cousins, one is a gold medal winner in the shot put, and the other one was a javelin Olympian, and it was an absolutely fabulous, fabulous day. We were able to recognize them at our breakfast. We had the news media was there. We had great press, guys, in Gresham, and they stayed almost the whole morning, they meaning the press. So KGW was there at the chamber event at 8 o'clock in the morning, and they stayed through the assembly that we had at Barlow. They even went to some of the grade schools where the boys were able to be role models to some kids. It was wonderful. I was very proud of it. So the Olympic days, see what happens, Mike, when you come late? And Matt, you know, we're going to have to find a seat for you. We will make sure that that happens. I know. They always blame the other person. All right, so we have invited today candidates in our area that the chamber has endorsed. We've endorsed a couple of candidates that are not here today. One is Dennis Richardson, and the other one is Carolyn Eccles. But Carolyn ended up showing up today, and we're really pleased with that. But the reason she's not part of the speaking part today is because she has an uncontested race. So to be gentle on her and to give more time to the other candidates, she graciously said, I don't need to talk. They can come to a council meeting and hear me talk. So thank you, Carolyn, for that. We also had another race that we didn't include this morning, and that was the race that Senator Lori Moniz Anderson, Tammy Arnold, and Jeffrey Ricks are in. And the reason for that is that I made the decision before we called anybody, in the races that we didn't endorse, if they all can't come, none of them can come, and to make it fair and square for all. And in that particular race, there was one of the candidates that couldn't attend, so we didn't have them. But in the other contested race that you'll see in just a minute, all of the candidates could attend, and we appreciate that. If you're interested in the endorsement process and how the chamber is doing that, please go online, go to our website. It's all lined out there. It's perfect explanation, very methodical, a very fair process for all. So check it out. So let's get started. Brian, are you ready? You've got a little chicken right here. Here we go. There we go. Okay.
Which side?
I'd like you to please welcome to the podium the chair of our Government Affairs Council, owner of PDG Construction Services, Brian Lessler.
Thank you. Thanks, Lynn. When she told me I was going to have to set up here all by myself, I thought I needed a jester hat, but she wouldn't accommodate that, so got me as I am. Well, welcome, and thank you for attending our general election candidate forum. We have 11 candidates today that you will have the opportunity to get to know a little better, hopefully. The format today is really quite simple. Each candidate will have 3 minutes to speak. We'll invite you to come to the podium. They will let you know who they are, perhaps why they are running, and what they hope to accomplish if elected. We invited the county commissioner candidate, two state representative candidates, city council candidates from Gresham and Troutdale, all of whom have been endorsed by the Chamber of Commerce. Unfortunately, the Troutdale mayor, as Lynn mentioned, is not able to attend. He called Friday, and he was very disappointed the last minute. He has a work conflict, has something to do with one of our sponsors, Riverview Bank and M Bank. I don't know, it's all very complicated mergers and acquisitions stuff. So anyhow, Larry can clue us in later. We also have included one state representative race, and all three candidates for that that are running are here. And there was no endorsement given by the chamber for this particular office. If you happen to be curious as to why we have included Troutdale City Council races in our forum, the question's really quite easy to answer. Decisions made in the surrounding communities can strongly affect our city, the city of Gresham. And economic development for East County requires a very collaborative effort between the cities and the community at large. And Mayor Bemis isn't here today, but I know he could tell you a lot of stories about issues that the city of Gresham and the city of Portland have had to resolve on our western border. Ted Wheeler was here as a guest speaker at one of our business and leaders luncheon, and he pointed out a number of areas where that race and the mayor's office could affect the outcome of things here in Gresham. So it's very important that Troutdale Council decisions have the same potential impact to us locally. Plus, we have many Gresham Chamber members that are Troutdale business owners or live in Troutdale. So it is appropriate that we respect and honor those Chamber members by providing a forum for their thoughts as well. So here's how things are gonna roll. After each candidate gives their 3-minute position speech, it will be time for question and answers. I'm going to invite each candidate to the podium to speak, and then the questions will be asked of all candidates, and they can just stay at the table to answer. There will be a microphone passed around, and you can give us your thoughts from there. Each question will be asked of all candidates, as I mentioned, and there are forms on the table. If the yellow form, if you would like to have a question, please get it to Lynn. She'll bring it up to me. We'll try to combine like questions, so we're fairly short of time today, so we're going to try to move through this as quickly as possible. Raise your questions up. Angela or Lynn will pick it up. Each candidate will have 2 minutes to answer the question, and precisely 2 minutes, no more. There will be a bell that goes off, and I have a hook, so. time permitting, we're also going to ask the three candidates running for District 50 a few extra questions, giving them their time to make the case for your personal endorsement. Shelley is going to be our timekeeper, and so we're going to get rolling. So our first candidate that I would like to invite to the podium is Lori Stegmann, council or candidate for Multnomah County Commissioner. Please welcome Lori.
Well, good afternoon. My name is Lori Stegmann. I'm running for Multnomah County Commission District 4 because I want kids in our community to have the same opportunities that I had growing up. I was born in Seoul, Korea, and I was adopted when I was just 6 months old. And I was so fortunate to be adopted by a loving family who gave me food, shelter, and a quality public education. But as lucky as I was, there were times when our family struggled. I remember the days of government cheese and when food stamps were actually stamps. My dad had only a sixth grade education, yet he was one of the smartest men that I've ever known. He taught me about the importance of education and that it was the only pathway out of poverty. And although it took me about 11 years to get my 4-year college degree, I did it, one night class after another. I think I turned out pretty good, and I think that if other kids have those same opportunities, they'll have a huge chance of success as well. I'm proud of my community service for the last 6 years as a Gresham City Councilor, a Gresham Redevelopment Commissioner, my countless hours of volunteer efforts, and my 22 years as a business owner in Gresham. Once I'm elected, I'm going to focus on three areas: education, housing affordability, and jobs. For education, I want to focus more resources on the Sun School programs, also more funding for the Summer Works program. For housing affordability, I want to continue to work collaborative with the partnership of A Home for Everyone. I'm very proud that the City of Gresham is a partner in that coalition and that we reached our goal in 2015 of finding housing for all veterans. I'll encourage development by advocating for policies that reduce building costs and remove the bureaucratic red tape like our 66-day industrial review permit process. I'll continue to support policies that assist first-time home buyers like our new home buyer assistance program. Most importantly, I will focus on jobs and economic development. I'm so excited for the 2017 groundbreaking for the Rockwood Rising redevelopment that will create an economic engine and support local entrepreneurs. We'll have a presence from Malheur Community College, the Small Business Development Center, MetroEast Community Media, as well as we'll make up the components for a grocery store. I also want to create an economic development department that will work with cities like our Garage to Storefront program that will promote small businesses to open up storefronts. I am proud of the amazing endorsements that I have received from our own Mayor Shane Bemis to our entire council as well as the chamber, to Multnomah County Sheriff Mike Reese and current County Commissioner Diane McKeel. Having the confidence of these incredible leaders has been a humbling experience. Because of this support, on day one, I will hit the ground running. But it is my ability to build consensus, trust, and partnerships that will enable me to truly make a difference and represent East County. Thank you.
Next, I'd like to invite to the podium Jerry Hinton, Gresham Council candidate for position number one. Jerry, welcome.
Hello again, my name is Jerry Hinton, and I am up for re-election at council position number one. Just to give you a quick resume background of myself, I went to Brigham Young University with a finance degree. After my first year, I actually served a two-year mission for my church in Bolivia, speaking Aymara Indian and Spanish at 14,000 feet with the Andes, up in the Andes Mountains with Aymara Indians. Went back and finished my degree at Brigham Young University. Then took a job with an auto, wholesale auto auction chain, which I have worked for over 30 years now. Went also received a law degree, started at McGeorge School of Law, then got an MBA degree from National there in Sacramento, and then moved up and was transferred to Oregon and finished up my law degree at Concord. I have been very blessed with my career and being able to use that as a as a pulpit for doing lots of service-related items. As a city councilor, this is again my second term. Been able to work with a great city council, very cohesive group of folks that we've been able to, I think, affect some significant change here in the Gresham area. I've been on the impact or the Multnomah or the Metro Policy Advisory Committee, the East County Transportation Committee, the Citizen Involvement Committee, the Budget and Policy and Finance Committee, and a number of other multiple subcommittees. My father was a city councilor when he was a younger man in Hurricane Utah, and he told me that it was a great thing to do. It was something that was very rewarding, and I absolutely agree 100% with my father. I am what you would call possibly one of your business candidates. Certainly this is the audience for that, and I recognize that as being a business leader for 30 years, managing a company with about 180 employees, $200 million in sales, and I am now the president-elect of the National Auto Auction Association with $200 billion in sales. One quick anecdotal story. You know, my wife and I took up scuba diving a few years back, and we were all decked out in the scuba gear. Everybody looks like a SEAL, right? You can't really tell the difference one person from another when you're scuba diving in the Puget Sound at 50 degrees. So we all go down into the water, and we're with a group of about six people. And as we're descending, I decide to be amorous and romantic with my wife, and I'm holding her hand as we're descending. And that was just a lovely time, 50 minutes in the water. We start coming back out, and we're walking up the shoreline, and one of my friends, who's 6'4" and 350 pounds, said, "Who's been holding my hand?" And so the point of that story, other than being extremely embarrassed but having a nice time, is to look at your candidate and look past the political veneer of just the suit and tie and what they say today in the rhetoric. Look at that and understand that we need to look at what this person's life has been and how they've served others. And it's all about service to others. And thank you so much for your time. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Jerry. The next candidate, it is my pleasure to invite to the podium, is David Widmark, running for council position number 5, I believe. Mr. Widmark. Welcome, David.
Thank you. First off, I want to thank the Chamber Executive Committee for their endorsement for position number 5 for the City of Gresham. This is my 6th time to be either running or appointed to City Council. I've been doing this since 1996. It's because I care about my community. I love my community, and it's something that I feel passionate about. I've been involved in Gresham different activities for over 40 years. And I continue to be amazed at what this community does and how it grows and how it expands. A little bit about myself. I'm retired from the U.S. Forest Service. I was a public affairs officer for them, and it was a great career. I also feel that that has given me background in how I communicate with citizens, how I address issues. And I think that I can also say that, you know, being a business-friendly community, being family-friendly, contributes to making Gresham a really great place. And I have this gut feeling that Gresham is really on the cusp of something great. Something is going to happen. and I think that we have great days ahead of us in this community. I need to stop for just a minute and say I've got a numb mouth. I had an emergency oral surgery this morning at 9 o'clock. So you never want to talk to a politician, I guess, who has a numb mouth. So bear with me. So anyways, some of the things that, you know, I hope to accomplish in the future is to continue our strong business alliance that we have, not only with the chamber, but also with our surrounding communities. I also feel that we have a very strong alliance with other partners, being the city of Portland. I also have to say that I also serve on the board and represent Gresham as a commissioner for Home Forward, that we provide housing for over 16,000 housing units within Multnomah County. So I represent not only Gresham in that aspect, but I also represent all individuals that live in Multnomah County. So with that, I just want to say that I, again, am humbled, and I want to thank the chamber for their endorsement. I feel that I am a strong candidate for this position, and that I will continue to do the best I can as an elected official to move our community forward to great days ahead. Thank you very much.
Next, Randy Lauer, running for Troutdale City Council, position number 2. Randy, I'd love to welcome you to the podium.
Thank you. So, appreciate it. So public speaking is not my forte, so I have some notes that I'd like to go over. First off, I just wanted to say thank you to the Chamber of Commerce for not only supporting these awesome and amazing candidates, but for also supporting the community as well. Local chambers are an important part of the communities, and I think we should do our part to support them. My name is Randy Lauer, and I am running for Troutdale City Council position 2. As a lifelong resident of, I'm gonna hold my phone up here, this is easier. As a lifelong resident of Gresham and a transplant to Troutdale about 5 years ago, my roots are set pretty deep in East County. I was pretty fortunate to be adopted as a young age to a very loving family, something that my birth parents weren't able to give, like nurturing and a steady home life, my family was able to provide. I'm a Latino American, my brother is white, and my two sisters are Korean, so diversity is something that my family has dealt with and something that we had to learn at a pretty young age, and it's something that I appreciate very much about my family. I plan on bringing a lot of the same values that my father, Ken, instilled in me, like honesty, dedication, and loyalty to the City of Council, Troutdale, or the Troutdale City of Council, and I'm very excited to get that going. I've been a municipal utility worker for the past 13 plus years. I've been serving the community of Wood Village for the past 5. I came from the city of Troutdale for a few years and by way of the city of Portland Water Bureau, all of which in their drinking water departments. I'm a father to a wonderful teenage boy, Mason. He's 14. He's going to be 15 in January. And a partner of a very loving woman, Chaucy. She is probably my backbone, my rock, and everything. She supports me. She's not a big time political person, but she supports me 100% in everything that I do, and I couldn't ask for anything other than that. As an independent and a progressive candidate, I'm running because I care for the city of Troutdale. I care about the direction Troutdale is headed. I've been fortunate to be endorsed by some pretty awesome local leaders, like Mayor Bemis sitting over there, Mayor Douse, Mayor Tosterud, Mayor Smith of Wood Village, and some pretty amazing state leaders. Also the Chamber of Commerce. I just wanna do my part in keeping what they've seen in me up front and do the best job that I can when elected to this Troutdale City Council position too. So thank you with that, and I appreciate it, and I will look forward to the questions after this. Thank you.
Thank you, Randy. It's now an honor to welcome to the podium Rob Canfield, who's running for Troutdale Council for 4.
Welcome. Thank you. I do want to thank the chamber for their endorsement. It's really an honor.
And I want to thank the chamber for inviting me to this event for lunch. It was good, wasn't it good? My wife and I moved to Troutdale in 2001. But my roots in this community go way back to 1952. My mom and my dad first met on a blind date at Tippecanoe. And I have the menu. My mom kept the menu. You could get a porterhouse steak dinner for $2.25, plus 20% excise tax. My mom said my dad just poured his soul out to her and she fell in love on the spot. So I'm glad for that. I'm back in the community. So you wonder, why am I running? I'm running for a couple of reasons. Number one, I love this community, the Troutdale. It is, after all, the center of the universe. I am worried about our kids in junior high school and high school. I'm worried if they're going to have jobs in our town after they graduate from high school and college. I'm really worried about that. Will they have to commute to Beaverton, Hillsborough, or Vancouver, or can we successfully complete our urban renewal area? Can we get our city to be more helpful to businesses? You know, Troutdale has a reputation, unfortunately, of being tough to get permits for about small businesses. And when that happens, we lose jobs. It'll go someplace else. And we also lose the tax revenue that the Troutdale needs. Another reason I'm running is public safety. You know, the most important job of any city is keeping its citizens safe. And when we merged the Troutdale Police Department with the Multnomah County Sheriff's, our service level for police safety went up, that we have more patrols than ever. And on top of that, we saved several hundred thousand dollars a year by doing this. Now, here's a small issue. It's my opponent, Glenn White. He wants to kill that deal. He wants to go back to the old way. I promise if I'm elected, I'll make sure we keep that high service level of public safety and continue to save all that money. So that's why I'm running. If you have any questions, you've got my palm card there. I don't know why they call them palm cards. They don't fit in anybody's palm. Mm-hmm. Thanks again, Chamber, for having me, and thanks again.
All right. And our third candidate for Troutdale Council position number 6 is John Wilson. John, welcome.
Glad to have you here.
Thank you. Well, good morning. My name is John Wilson. I work for the Gresham Outlook, so in the advertising department, so I can't write any stories for you, but I can sure get your name out of the public. We moved out to Troutdale in 91 from Oklahoma, and we found it a lot like Edmond, Oklahoma, where we were living out there, except no tornadoes. I grew up in Southern California, and when we first moved out here, I was down in Eugene sleeping, and I woke up to an earthquake, and I thought, where have I moved to? But some things about Troutdale. This is going to be my second term. Did you know that Troutdale has the 7th highest median income in the state of Oregon? Our average median income is $62,000. The median in the state is $50,000. Did you know that Troutdale is rated the number 2 on the best of the Portland suburbs for young people? First place was Sherman, then Troutdale, Happy Valley, Newburgh, Hillsboro, Westland. I'm sure the other cities are right behind us. In Troutdale, we are educated, okay? We do make money, and we have a great quality of life. And we are the secret gem of East County. In the last few years, ODOT has spent millions of dollars updating I-84 to include a walking, biking path over the Santa Ynez River. Also widening the underpass to make it two-way to relieve congestion. The Port of Portland is preparing the trip property for new businesses, and they're spending millions of dollars to do so. The Port of Portland is also updating the Troutdale Airport. Metro gives Troutdale $80,000 a year because we have a transfer station. And we pass that money on through grants to have great things happen. Like this year is our first year, and we got a new mural in Troutdale Mayor Square. We've got a historical society is repainting the caboose. We also help crackpots with their marketing plans. Troutdale is working with Metro on another possible connector on the Springwater Trail. Troutdale has a great police department, which Rob talked about. We merged it with the Multnomah County Sheriff's. We now have a building that is open 24/7. We have deputies on patrol the streets doing just what they need to do. Sergeants are available 24/7 to help them with decisions. And if that wasn't enough, we saved hundreds of thousands of dollars in doing this. When I voted to make this decision, it wasn't about saving money, it was about service. But the savings came along with it. But I'm getting behind here. So anyway, the reason I want to rerun is because our budget needs help. People are trying to save pennies when we need to find dollars. And those dollars are going to come from new businesses opening in the Trip property. Well, I guess that's it. So thank you very much. Too much to say.
All right. Thank you. Thank you very much, John. We're going to move on to our state offices now. And our first endorsed candidate is Mark Johnson, running for state representative of District 52. Mark.
Well, welcome. I guess, no, forget you're already here. I'm not going to welcome you here. Thank you for allowing me to be here today, and thank you for the endorsement from the Gresham Chamber. You know, from the candidate's perspective, we have multitudes of endorsement opportunities, right? All kinds of organizations, all kinds of groups, people, and so forth. But I can say beyond a shadow of a doubt that the Gresham Chamber endorsement application was the most intensive one of any of them. So I don't know if that was Lynn's job or Lynn's brainchild, but it was like the Inquisition. My gosh, felt like I was writing a term paper, but I'm glad I took the time instead of enrolling myself in the candidate protection program as my my opponent did. So it means a lot to me to be able to have this, though, because in my 6 years in the legislature, I'm running for my fourth term. You know, what I really prided myself on doing is getting to know the people that I represent and taking the time to listen to them, to sit down and look them in the eye, understand what their needs are, what their priorities are, what their values are. So I can take that with me to Salem because, you know, it's the title is representative, but the root word is represent. You know, this is not the position where any one of us here today should take our ideology and say, you elect me, I'm going to go be who I want to be in Salem, because I think that happens far too often, and we're getting far too many of those type of folks in the legislature, frankly, from my perspective. There aren't that many folks left that know how to find the sensible middle on issues, because that's just kind of the way Oregon is. Oregon is either very blue or it's very red. There aren't a lot of folks that know how to play on that sensible, moderate middle. And that's really where I think we find solutions, solutions that stand the test of time, solutions that are transcendent, and solutions that really address the problems that we have in this state. So for those of you who don't know me, I'm Mark Johnson from Hood River. So you're on the very far western fringe of my district. I have only about 4,000 or 5,000 voters in Multnomah County, but I represent a lot of dirt. Because I go from the college all the way to the Hood River County line, so I've got Corbett and all that, and I've got a couple precincts in Gresham too. But I love the area, you know, and my area is, I think, you know, when you've got all the Columbia River Gorge, at least that part of the gorge that has trees, and you've got all of Mount Hood in your district, you represent a pretty special piece of real estate. But the communities are what really make it valuable to me. So from Bridal Veil to Boring to Brightwood, all of these are the communities that make up my district, and I love to work with them. I love to get to know them and immerse myself in what they're all about. So I'm a contractor. I build homes. At least I used to pound a lot more nails than I do now, but it certainly is a good stress reliever to spend 5 months in session and then go back home and pound nails and stuff with a hammer for a while. That's what I do. I've got a great family. They're successful kids. My wife's an oncology nurse, so she understands what stress is all about as well, and serving others. So I'm just proud to be able to be here today, to have your support, and look forward to answering more questions here today. So thank you.
Perfect timing. Please give a welcome to Lori Chavez, running for State Representative District 51. Uno. Thank
you. You like that uno, because that's the Chavez, right? So I see here today I am Lori Chavez. When I moved to Oregon, I was Lori De-Remer. And when I got married, I was Lori Chavez De-Remer. In California, they call me Chavez. Here, they call me De-Remer. But Lori Chavez De-Remer is my name. I am running for District 51, which is, most of you know, Clackamas, eastern portion of Happy Valley, Damascus, Boring, Gresham, and East Portland. So it's a very diverse community. I have been the mayor of Happy Valley for the last 6 years and on city council for 6 years before that. And why do we run for office? We often ask ourselves that. And when I ran for mayor, it was because I had twin daughters who were 6 years old. We'd chosen to live in Oregon. My husband took a job here after medical school. After 16 years of, we met in high school when we were 15. And we started that long journey and I thought, what in the hell am I getting myself into? But I loved him and I still love him today, 25 years later. So we chose Oregon after medical school. Our daughters were six and we thought, why Oregon? We'd never even been here. And the most beautiful state that I have ever lived in, and I've lived in a lot of states. Happy Valley, my husband took a job at Kaiser Hospital. He's an anesthesiologist. We own and operate our own business now since 2005. So as a mom, a wife, a business owner, why elected office? Because all you care about is the community, the story. We heard stories along the way. We all have our stories. Why do they matter? And why do they matter when you're running for public office? Because it's all about community. Who do we relate to? Who understands us? And how then do we transcend that message in our communities? So I ran for city council in 2004, was elected. Again in 2010, then I ran for mayor, and again elected in 2014. First Hispanic mayor and first woman mayor. Now why is that important? It's important because leadership is what we're missing in Salem. Leadership is why I stand before you today. I can work with Mayor Bemis, who's hiding over there. You know, the metropolitan mayors get together, and often I tell them, they made fun of me for stepping up to this, and they said, are you insane about leaving, you know, your community and going for the state legislature? And I thought, if more of us did that, if more city councilors and mayors did that, and we ran for state office, then we could come home, we could stand up here, and we can get out of all of your way. All you people who are running for city council and mayors, you know what you're doing, because you're right here in the community holding hands with the people who matter. So it is my job to be with Representative Johnson in the next 28 days. To be elected, to get out of your way, get out of the business's way in order to make a difference in the state. So I'm very excited to stand up here and answer these questions about transportation, education, jobs, but really it's about getting to know you and getting out of the way. So I cannot thank the chamber enough for endorsing me on this campaign and representing you in Salem come January. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary. And now we have three candidates for State Representative District 50. The three candidates are in alphabetical order, Stella Armstrong, Michael Calcagno, and Carla Piluso. So I'll invite them up in that order. So Stella Armstrong, would you please come and let us get acquainted with you. Thank you.
Thank you for inviting me here. I will apologize in advance because English is now my native language. So I'm from the Philippines. I was born and raised there. So please bear with me. Okay. And I do appreciate very much the format of the discussion that we have here today. It provides a very safe environment for me, and you are all welcoming, so thank you so much. I was born and grew up in the Philippines before I migrated here almost 9 years ago. All my work experience and academic background was in education. I have a doctorate in educational management and was a university professor, administrator, researcher, writer. So I taught teaching courses and mentored teachers, evaluated curriculum, designed curriculum. I was for a time regional accreditor of universities and colleges in that region. And so what I do is I look at processes, processes, see which ones worked and which ones didn't, and fixed holes, so to speak. I was for a time a vice dean of the College of Liberal Arts in my university, De La Salle University in Manila. And for a time, I taught at University of Washington in Seattle as a Fulbright Asian Scholar in Residence. I had to come home after that one. I could have stayed longer because my dad got sick. And I had written some reference books for use in college and high school and won some national awards there. And like what Lori said, when I told my aunt I'm getting married and moving to Oregon, she said, "Oregon? Oregon? Oregon?" And we had to stop her because she couldn't stop saying Oregon. And why Oregon? And so I came here with expectations. And settling here, I got to know our students who struggle academically and faced various challenges. For 6 years, I was the program and literacy instructor for a sign-up after-school program, helping elementary students, getting to know the students who did not know how to read and how to add. And as an avid tutor, both for the Gresham Barlow School District and Reynolds School District, I got to meet and help high school students and middle school students who still do not know how to read and write. And now I am the transitions coordinator at Mount Hood Community College. It's a program for women who are struggling to access education. And for me, that completed the whole cycle. I call it my postdoctorate degree, getting to know education in both the highs and the lows. And I hope to be able to contribute what I know in education for our kids here in Gresham. Thank you.
Next, please welcome Michael Calcagno.
Yeah, good to see you too. Gosh, driving in, wasn't it just gorgeous? These leaves coming out, the colors. We are so blessed to live in this state. The fall in Oregon is just tremendous. So my name is Michael Calcagno, and I'm a candidate for the Oregon Legislature in House District 50. I'm running for office because I care about the people in my community. I care about the single mom who's working her way through Mount Hood Community College and trying to improve her life. I care about the small business owner who's trying to grow and finding it very difficult in this climate that we've created, trying to offer good paying jobs right here in this community. And I care about the fourth grader who is crammed into a classroom with 38 or 39 students to one teacher, and he doesn't have running water at home. So these aren't imaginary people. These are real people who I know and who I want to help when I get to Salem. We have a lot of challenges in this state, and it doesn't take a politician to know that. It just takes picking up the paper, because every day we see more stories about waste in government, about programs that aren't doing what they're intended to do, about foster kids who are starving. And a lot of these things are really daunting, but I think there is tremendous opportunity and there's tremendous upside when we can find more balance in Salem. So a little bit about me. I grew up here in Gresham. I went to high school here. My family has grown roots in this community for more than three generations. I live here in Gresham today. I'm a homeowner with my wife, Katie. She's a public school teacher, and I run a small business, and we have our first child, a baby girl, on the way. So when I think about the opportunities that she'll have in life, the reality is stark. So she has a 1 in 4 chance of being a high school dropout. She has a 1 in 5 chance of growing up to live on food stamps, and those statistics are real numbers, and it's my generation moving into this society that has to think about our kids and future generations. And so when we look at priorities ahead, there are three simple things that I'd like to address in Salem, and that is better jobs that provide for better living wages schools and affordability, because we have a true affordability crisis in our state. So firstly, on jobs, we have to address transportation. I don't think there is an issue that is more critical. We have to talk about business over regulation and the climate that we're creating in this state. And we have to talk about agriculture, because we are not capitalizing on the economic driver, which is agriculture in this state. Then we have to talk about schools. I serve on the school board at Mount Hood Community College, and I'm proud to say that we've lowered tuition, we've increased access for veterans, and we've better integrated career and technical training into our high schools. And those are things I'm really proud of. And we have to talk about, I think when we talk about schools, we talk about 38 or 39 kids in a classroom. I think we have to talk about integrating social service funds with our school funds so that we can see better classrooms in Oregon. And then we have to talk about land use reform to address affordability. So my name is Michael. I look forward to answering your questions. Thank you so much for being here and for your time today.
Last but certainly not least, our incumbent, Carla Piluso. Welcome, Carla.
Well, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Carla Piluso, and I am very honored to be here today. As I near the end of my first term as a state representative for House District 50, that's representing most of Gresham and a small portion of Southeast Portland, I appreciate the opportunity to share the success of my first term as a state representative and the priorities I have to keep moving Oregon forward with all of you. During my first 2 years as a state representative, I am proud to have brought huge successes home for Gresham, including $1 million to help fund a Boys and Girls Club and an additional $1 million to help open an open school, both in Rockwood. A $30 million increase in funding for temporary assistance for needy families. A bill that was later signed into law to create a Women's Veterans Coordinator to help women vets around the state access their benefits. And $2 million to continue funding the East Metro Gang Enforcement Team, which was started under my watch more than 10 years ago when I was police chief. I have lived and worked and played in East County for nearly 40 years. For 30 of those years, I proudly served as a Gresham police officer, and rising through the ranks was promoted to police chief, the first woman in Gresham to fill this role. I am lucky to have been able to raise my bright, healthy daughter, Kate, in this community. After graduating from Willamette University last year, she is now living in New Jersey, teaching at a school for at-risk youth while working on her master's degree. I balanced every aspect of my career with community service. I currently serve as the chair of the Gresham Barlow School Board. I continue to serve as the board president of Human Solutions, now cresting 18 years. I chaired the Multnomah County Commission on Children's, Families, and Community for 12 years. I'm a member of the Salvation Army Advisory Council, an active volunteer with Snowcat Community Charities, a member of the American Association of University Women, and recently joined the board of the Gresham Historical Society. And whenever possible, I have not refused to host an event, MC an event, auctioneer, dance the waltz like never been danced before at the Gresham Elks. The mayor can attest to that. Betty can attest to that. To be a keynote speaker or push a bed in the annual Gresham bed races. For me, these are opportunities to give back to my community. In my role as a representative, I maintain the same priorities I have throughout my entire career. Public safety, keeping our community safe by maintaining strong programs and funding for the criminal justice system. Education, providing all our kids a first-class education by providing a well-funded and safe environment for learning. Family success, advocating for working-class families by supporting programs and policies designed to prevent and reduce poverty. My commitment to my community is the same commitment I make to you. My door will always be open to hear your concerns and to help resolve those concerns in the best possible way. I am grateful for the support I have received from my community in my first race to the State House and throughout my time as state representative. I am committed to maintaining and expanding the relationships I have in East County and hope that you will join me in helping to do what's best for Gresham in 2017 and beyond. Thank you very much.
All right, now we're going to move on to some questions. And I think we're going to have to put 10 pounds of marbles in a 5-pound bag here, because there are a lot of questions. We do have a questions, and it relates to ballot measure 97, the gross receipts tax. That campaign is now in full swing. All of you, I believe, but State Representative Piluso are on the record as opposing the initiative. Please tell us why you oppose or support ballot measure 97.
This is Lori. As a Gresham City Councilor, our council took action to formally oppose Measure 97 because it is a regressive sales tax and it's going to hurt the very people that we want to help most.
John Wilson, Troutdale City Council, and I oppose Measure 97.
Wonder why?
Because, like Lori said, it is a tax on a tax. So if you take medication, you're going to pay a lot more for it. If you're in the automobile industry, it's going to hit you hard. There's not one area of your life that it's going to have an effect on.
By the way, we changed the format a little. They were supposed to get 2 minutes, but they're only getting one, so we can get through more questions. So, Mark?
I can sit. Great, thank you. Oh, I can stand. That's allowed. Oh, okay. Okay, all right. Stand up, sit down, fight. I'm a strong opponent of 97, but I'm going to get into a different reason why. You've heard it said, even by our governor, unfortunately, that we have to pass 97 because there are no other options on the table. It's incorrect. I stood with Senator Mark Hass last February while we were in the February session where he unveiled another option he had put together as chair of the Senate Finance Committee, working with our legislative fiscal office to put together another revenue reform package as a conversation starter. It fell on deaf ears because the battle lines had already been drawn by that time. The public employee unions are lined up and the business communities lined up, and it was going to be this battle royal. But there are other options out there, and I stand with Mark Hass. I just talked with him about it last week. We're ready to go to work, roll up our sleeves, and we get back to Salem next session after Met 97 is voted down and work on substantive revenue reform within a legislative committee environment and not at the ballot box, because that's how you make good sound policy. Thanks.
I also strongly oppose Measure 97. I think I saw a commercial last night. There's some economist that said that this would not be passed to the consumer. I don't know what kind of an economist he is, but it doesn't take a brain surgeon to realize that that's who is ultimately going to be paying the price for this. My business alone, if we would not pass that along to the consumer, we'd be out of business immediately. So we, like many others, recognize that it would be just absolutely devastating to the business community in Oregon.
That was Jerry. I want to make sure everybody recognizes who. Michael is next.
So 38,000 jobs will be gone with Measure 97 passing. So anything that kills that many private sector jobs is not something that I can support. So I'm strongly against 97. There are no exemptions with typical sales taxes. Basic household goods are exempted so that the most vulnerable citizens aren't as impacted. So we're talking, you know, heating for your home, we're talking fuel, we're talking groceries and prescription medications. Those things are not exempted and will see higher costs. And if our goal is to combat the affordability crisis, if our goal is to prevent more poverty, and if our goal is to create private sector jobs, Measure 97 is a job killer, and it's a cost of living increase, and it's not something I can support. There are other options. We have to do the work to find those options.
Rob?
I'm strongly opposed to Measure 97. It is a multiplier effect as the products go through the product cycle. It's a multiplier effect. Also, it's estimated that it's going to affect households about $600 per capita. How is the family struggling to support itself right now going to do that? Do they have extra money? No. The other thing that is really concerns me is right now the state of Oregon is having record tax revenues right now. And as usual, it's a spending problem in Oregon. It's not a revenue problem. I'm totally against this.
Stella?
Go to the state of Oregon site and look up this article. I like it because it's actually a report about Measure 97 by the state of Oregon. And it says, it is going to be successful if the government or the state would be able to know how to spend the money. And we know we haven't been in this, we would not be in this position if the state knew in the first place how to spend money. So go read this one. There's no debate about it. Everything is here. So I'm voting no for Measure 97. It will kill jobs in the private sector, in retail, wholesale, health services. So read this one so that you'll be informed that even the state says it's not going to work.
Lori Chavez, De-Remer. I am in opposition to Measure 97 for the very thing that I was talking about earlier. I've been working for 12 years in the fastest growing city in Oregon to bring jobs to East County. And the very thing that we're going to do now is kill what we've been working on for so long. So payroll tax, property tax, income tax. We want people to have jobs. We want people to pay that payroll tax. We want people to own homes. We want them to pay property tax and income tax. And now we're going to kill those very jobs that where the revenue comes from the state. So again, yes, we might have limited resources at the state of Oregon, but we have more of an expenditure problem, and 97 is not going to be the answer to that problem. So I am in complete opposition to Measure 97.
Carla?
So I am in favor of 97. So Oregon can fund our schools, make healthcare more affordable, and care for Oregon seniors. If voters approve this measure in November, I'll go to Salem to make sure that all new revenue is invested just as the measure says. In the schools, our kids deserve affordable health care and quality care for our seniors.
Randy?
As an independent and issues-driven voter, I tend to look at all aspects before casting a vote. When people tell us that there's only one way and only the right way, again, it just seems like we're not looking at the whole picture. I don't support 97 because there has to be another way. Anything that has the possibility of killing private sector jobs goes against what I stand for. So again, I oppose 97.
I oppose 97, pretty much what Randy just indicated. To me, I think that to only have one item on the ballot that deals with this issue without any other options, I find extremely disturbing, because how can we only have one solution to a huge problem? And I really would appreciate having more options available. I also stood behind my decision from the Gresham City Council as a member of opposing this, because I think it does hurt small business, it does hurt every size of business, and also the taxpayers of our community.
And that was David. Okay, Brian, I've already done my aerobics today, so we'll have another question. We'll start here and go back the other way.
Very good. Okay, this question is a combined question for many of you. So the question is this: what is the most pressing business problem that you perceive for the Gresham, Troutdale communities, and you can answer with respect to your own jurisdictions, or the East County region, which would be an important question for those running for state offices?
So just the problem, not the solution?
The problem and what they would do to solve it. Thank you.
No problem. I'm here to help.
Repeat the question.
What is the most pressing problem that you see for your jurisdiction, for City of Gresham in your case, and for business development, economic development, and what would you do to solve it?
I thought I heard. So, I think the most pressing issue that I see affecting businesses in this community is the ability to do business and do business better, and to provide the incentives to bring business to our community. That I think that we have to look at all the options. I feel that our development group at the city has done a great job in attracting business, but we have to continue to work with the port, particularly on the Vista site, and as we move forward with that. I think that those are issues that will always be here, but we will need to have the right people at the right table making the right decisions.
And that was David. Randy?
Please state your name as you start.
Randy Lauer. Troutdale has the benefit of being populated by working aged folks. I think the average age of Troutdale residents is between 36 and 38. The average distance that our residents travel to go to work is around 20 miles.
Yeah.
That means the people that have invested enough to start a family, to live here in Troutdale, they leave to go to work. We need to do a better job working with in our borders, creating jobs, developing our sites, give the citizens an opportunity to work in the city where they live. I think that should be an important factor going forward. Thank you.
Brett, I am going to ask for the question one more time.
Sure. The question is, please share your number one priority to support businesses in East County and what you would do, or number one problem, what you would do to resolve that issue.
Well, I tell you one thing, and again, at the state level, at a regional level, one thing I'm very concerned about is the transportation needs that are in our community in order to get both services and product into our community. We need a very comprehensive transportation plan, and I see that in the works in Salem. I see that happening, but I think we need better input from our region to actually address the needs that are specific to our region.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, I'd like to add to that. Transportation, I do sit for Clackamas County, and a lot of your representatives, the mayor and I, have had conversations at the mayor's table, but also on JPAC and also the Region 1 Act, which comes out toward Hood River and so forth. And you know, the votes are just not there when you compare it to Portland. So we hammer the infrastructure side. And what we can do as cities and what we can do at the state level is to get out of the way. Again, we have so much regulation and red tape that we continue to put on our businesses and our homeowners that you can't get past it. So you saw it didn't pass in the last session, the transportation package. It didn't pass in the session before because we can't manage to get out of each other's way and just deal with transportation. Left or right, there isn't one person that I've talked to that doesn't think infrastructure is the number one thing needed in the state to support homeowners, businesses, goods and services across the state. You have the port. You've got to, I mean, look at Terminal 6. Look what it did to this part of East County. So that's an issue. The other thing is going to be compounding for the jobs, right? So 90% of Happy Valley people drive out just like out here, and we need them to stay here and create those jobs. It's red tape. I'm telling you, as elected officials, we got to get out of the way and let the people of the community make those decisions.
And Troutdale it has a reputation of being hard to do business with. Guy came to a city council meeting a couple months ago, berating the city council. His application, his paperwork had sat on somebody's desk for 4 months. He couldn't get a return phone call. I don't want to bash city staff. We've got a great city staff, but there has to be a way to stop that and streamline the process, make Troutdale more easy to do business with. What I'm proposing on my website is a semi-regular get-together of business folks who are starting new businesses or have existing businesses, and with city staff. Businesses can say, this is how you can streamline our process so we're easy to open up, and businesses can help the city can help the businesses figure out, this is the way to navigate our system. Open communication is the way to go on that, and I think that'd go far to solve this problem of Troutdale not being easy to do business with.
I'm Stella Armstrong again. So I agree with Rob and Laurie. It's over-regulation of businesses here. But for me, the other important factor, I call it the negativity factor, or I sense an antagonistic perception toward business or business in general. And I think it's time for us to stop dividing, you know, the state or Gresham into rich and poor, business or non-business, because business drives economy and we need business. But I have this sense that they are always the enemy, they're the cause of the problem, and they're always targeted. So that has to stop.
Michael Calcagno, I think that there are two
major problems that I see, and that's transportation, and it's also workforce. So I serve as a school board member at Mount Hood Community College, and we have the programs that can train our workers, our residents in East County for the family wage jobs that exist. But one of the biggest problems is that more than half of the students coming into Mount Hood Community College from our local high schools need sub 100 level remedial math and English education. So our high schools aren't doing a great job at feeding us the students that are ready to take the jobs that are freeing up as boomers retire. And then transportation. So in 2015 and in 2016, my opponent had a chance to lead on transportation, but sided with her party. And that's a big problem. We need more balance. We need more independence. And I hope to be that voice in Salem. Thanks.
I would just have to say, I think the state of Oregon is probably the biggest drag on the East County economy that I represent. A couple of issues I'll touch on. The minimum wage hike passed in February. Sure, big idea, way too short of amount of time to consider in February, but we know that that will cost jobs among small businesses because I hear from them. It's going to provide fewer job opportunities for the youth that we're trying to equip for the next for their workforce and so forth. Don't forget paid sick time. We added that onto the burden of small businesses as well. Now, if you've got 10 employees, you have to provide mandatory paid sick time for them as well, and that also applies to agricultural folks as well. Don't forget your farmers are going to have to be complying with this and keeping records. And on ag-related pressures, there are just a numerous ones that have been put upon our nursery industry out here in East County. Paid overtime now is also becoming an issue that is likely to be considered in the next session. So you can't just work workers for anything more than 40 hours a week. They'd have to have another structure for compensating them. Again, these are commodities-based producers. They can't create a price for their product. They get what the market provides for them. And as we continue to drive up costs, they'll be less profitable, fewer opportunities for job opportunities, and they'll certainly be much less financially viable.
That was Mark.
Jerry Hinton, I would say amen to just about everything everybody said so far. Transportation, infrastructure, getting out of the way of business. I definitely believe in Adam Smith's invisible hand and that the market will take care of itself. Government's number one role is the safety of its citizens, not taking care of businesses in terms of getting in their way and creating red tape. So red tape definitely is a huge deal. A couple other things, and again, to Mark's issue with the minimum wage, that's just absolute killer. I can't believe Oregon did that. It's going to cost my business alone $1 million a year in doing that, which is going to create all kinds of issues and cutbacks and things that I won't be able to do that I would have done otherwise. For not only our employees, but our the community at large. Also, just the cost of land in trying to create new businesses. Here in this area, we're blessed to have the Gresham Vista and have that 230 acres of shovel-ready land, the most in anywhere else in the metro area. However, the urban growth boundary being tied up with so much of the Damascus debacle has tied up a lot of that inventory of urban growth property. So we could certainly look at that as well in an expansion.
Thank you.
Lori Stegmann, as you probably have heard, this region is not known for being business friendly, and I think we need to change that. I want to emulate some of the things that the city of Gresham has done, like the Garage to Storefront program. This program says, we want you here. We have to send the message that we want business here. Some of the things that we can do to solve that issue are what we've done on the Gresham City Council, like the 66-day industrial review permit process and the Garage to Storefront program. So if you want to open a business, if you want to expand a business, we want you here, and we will get out of your way and waive some of those fees so that you can start a business here.
John Wilson, Troutdale City Council. Everybody's had a lot of great ideas. You know, another issue that I feel that is in our high schools. We've cut back so many programs that the kids that are not going to go to a four-year college don't have the technical skills that the manufacturing industry needs. And you hear it all the time that that industry is shrinking because we don't have the people to come fill it. I know that the college is working on that, but it needs to start at the high school level. I remember when I was in high school, we had industrial arts classes. How many schools have that today? Or we had summer school that we could take these industrial arts classes, or any classes we want. So I think that the schools need to bring back things for the kids that are not going to go to a four-year college but need technical training.
Okay, we've got time for one additional question to the three candidates from House District 50, 51, 52, 50?
50.
50, thank you.
House District 50.
Help me with the numbers. I'm not good at that.
51. So I have a whole bunch of questions here. Unfortunately, we only get to ask one. So I'd like to know, and it's been asked, what department of the state government needs most to have spending reined in, and how would you work with the state Secretary of State's office to oversee and monitor wasteful spending?
So, Michael Calcagno, you know, over the last decade in Oregon, we've seen the K-12 budget shrink and shrink and shrink. And the portion of the budget that's taking that shrinking K-12 funding is our social service programs. And while I firmly believe that we need a safety net to catch the most vulnerable citizens, we also need one that's efficient and effective and returns people to the dignity of work. And so I think that DHS has been in the news a lot lately. We see a failing foster care program with children who are put in offices in cots. That is a moral failing, and it is a failure of the incumbent party. And we have to do something about that. It cannot continue any longer. And that's why I feel so compelled to run, because, you know, I'm a young guy. I could run certainly 20 years from now. But I think that there is a calling right now of the failure that we have. 1 in 5 folks are on food stamps, and that is a serious problem. We have one of the worst labor participation rates in the country. We have to get people back to work, back on their feet, and we have to do, hopefully with Dennis Richardson, audits on DHS so that we can find effective and efficient programming again for DHS.
Thank you. Stella? Or
Carla Piluso. I have a different perspective on issues related to DHS. We were able, again, to secure, as I said earlier, $30 million for the TANF program, Temporary Assistance for Needy Families. That organization had not received any funding since 1992. I think that is a real blemish on our state for that gap of time without getting funding to our most vulnerable, getting them out of poverty, onto their own payroll, and it's huge. Also, I sit on the governor's task force related to foster care. Huge strides have been changing from the top to the bottom as we have replaced leadership and with a new sense of leadership. And I think we are seeing progress being made. We have to do the right thing for our kids, for our young people, so that they can be successful in their world, in their schools, and throughout the community.
Thank you. Stella?
Last time. I have to read. Education, that's why I am running. Before talking about any additional funding, we need to answer these following questions. Is the quality of teaching being evaluated honestly? Is the hiring process open to ensure that the best teachers are hired? Is there uniformity in what students are learning in each grade level? Are they learning the same things at the same time? Quality of instruction and uniformity in standards directly impact student performance. We need to know that these two are being evaluated fairly and honestly before we can conclude that any other factors are causing the decline in the quality of education and graduation rates of our students. No more money in a process with a lot of holes.
Thank you very much. Now I'll turn this back over to Lynn for closing comment.
Not bad, huh? Better than that debate on Sunday night. You guys did great. Oh my gosh. Shelley. Okay, but I have to tell you that we came prepared. Shelley, would you please get the bell? This is what was going to happen. I am so impressed that we didn't hear that once, so thank you. So I'm going to introduce one more time each candidate. So if you would stand, and then we'll applaud all of them at the end. So running for County Commissioner, Lori Stegmann. Thank you, Lori. Boy, you guys follow directions well. You can sit down, yeah. Oh, send the memo to my husband. He won't believe this. Council position for Gresham Council, position number one, Jerry Hinton. And I'm going to go a little off. Carolyn Eccles, position number three. Position number four for Gresham, excuse me, position number five for Gresham City Council, David Widmark. Troutdale Council position number two, Randy Lauer. Troutdale position number four for the council seat, Rob Canfield. Troutdale Council position number six, John Wilson. State Representative, District 52, Mark Johnson. You know, you're running a risk because I'm a voter in your district. Who's that other guy? Okay, never mind. State Representative District 51, Lori Chavez De-Remer, or Reaver De-Remer Chavez.
Chavez De-Remer.
There we go. Thank you. And the State Representative in District 50, Stella Armstrong.
Thank you.
Michael Calcagno. And Carla Piluso. Would you give every one of them a round of applause? Thank you so much. Thank you. Running for office has a life of its own. Doing the job has another life. So work hard to get them elected and then work hard to help them do the right thing for us when they get down there. I want to thank our sponsors one more time, Portland General Electric, Riverview Community Bank, Gresham Barlow School District, MetroEast Community Media. Please give them a round of applause too. Marty, thanks for joining us today. Don't forget, there is a replay of this, the BLT, I call it BLT, the BLL, the Business and Leaders Luncheon. There's a replay times when it's going to be replayed. And the memo, the information is on the registration desk for today's event as well as the Economic Summit. So grab one of those and be sure and take a look at what MetroEast does. Upcoming topics, we've got Ruth Miles coming up pretty soon. Next month, our Business and Leaders Luncheon happens on Election Day, so we're going to bring a comedian in. Please take a minute to complete the evaluation form at your seat and drive carefully. Enjoy the weather today. Go Beavers.